Around you, we just say a good morning. Good morning to those around you. Greet one another. Y'all, today is an especially exciting day because we get to celebrate baptism this morning. And I couldn't be more thrilled that we get to gather together and celebrate baptism this morning. If you're a guest with us, there's a connection card in the pew in front of you. If you would take a moment to fill that out at some point during the service, and you can just drop that in the plate at the end as you walk out, or you could hand it to a pastor. We'd love to get to know you better. We don't want to fill up your inbox or hound you or anything like that. We just want to greet you and get to know you a little bit better. So we're so thrilled to worship with you this morning.
Good morning, church. Great to see you this morning from the baptistry. We are blessed this morning. We have a candidate to baptize. Come on down, Addison. This is Addison Tyree Rodriguez, and he has put his faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. In fact, we did that some months ago in my office, and he's coming today to follow up on that now that we've got our pandemic stuff in a situation where we can to be baptized. And I know that you're excited about that and thrilled about that, and I hope that you will commit yourself to pray for him as he embarks on this journey of discipleship through his life, that God's Spirit would go with him and bless him. And we're excited about that ourselves. So without any further words or delay, Addison, you have professed faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Is it your confession that he is Lord of all creation and Lord of your life?
Yes.
Well, it's on the basis of that confession, my brother, that I baptize you in as my little brother in Christ, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We're buried with Christ in baptism and raised to live a new kind of life. All right, Addison, I give you this candle because Jesus said, "You are the light of the world. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven." So as you embark on this new experience in your life, we give you this candle to remind you that you are the light of the world. Let others see Christ in you, and you will be blessed. Okay, Karen. Amen. We praise God for everything that he does in the lives of those who give their faith and their trust to him. And I hope that you'll remember to pray for Addison as he continues to live for Christ in the days to come. And now I think Mike McLeod is going to come and lead us in our invocation.
Good morning and welcome to Central Baptist. Would you bow your heads, please, as we open in prayer? Our gracious Lord, how we bless your name and how we praise your name. As we have just witnessed a representation of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And Father, our prayer is that as we just saw this morning, we will see more often even those people who come to the Lord Jesus Christ for salvation through our work and through our faith. And Father, we praise you that you have sent Jesus Christ, your Son, to be our sufficient Savior. And I pray, Lord, that we would never forget what you have done. It is in your name that we pray. Amen.
Would you please stand and read with me the psalm that's printed as we begin our, continue in our worship this morning. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquities, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from destruction, and who crowns you with
kindness and mercy.
hear you this morning. Hear God's word from the 12th chapter of Hebrews. Therefore, since we're surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. And let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinful men, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. In your struggle against sin, you have not yet resisted to the point of shedding your blood. The hymn we're about to sing, I'm sure Charles Gabriel meditated on that and many such scriptures when he wrote, "I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene and wonder how he could love me, a sinner, condemned unclean, and yet how marvelous, how wonderful my song shall ever be, because how wonderful and how marvelous is my Savior's love for me." Let's sing it together.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sally. As we come to our prayer time, let me update you on a few things in the congregational care section of your worship bulletin. Gary Street has been discharged to go home, but is still waiting for a solution to the nerve pain that he's been suffering with for some while now. Sarah Tidings is now at Princeton Rehab. And Pete Veerling, whose name is not on your list, is in the Med Center getting some tests run. And sad to report, but Bob Graves was summoned into the presence of the Lord yesterday. He was ready to go. I visited with him last on Friday afternoon. Had a good visit. I wasn't expecting a transition quite so quickly, but he had received a serious diagnosis this week. And he expressed to me that his concern, of course, was for his family, but that he was ready and prepared to make his way into God's presence. And so we give thanks to God for that. You see the other concerns on your list, so let's take these and your concerns on your heart to the Lord together. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we give you thanks this day for your grace and your love. We thank you for the promise of your word, that our Lord Jesus, as he himself prepared to go to the cross, told his disciples that he was going to prepare a place for them and that he would return and receive them to himself. God, we're grateful that you've done that for Bob. You've done that for everyone who has trusted in you through the centuries. And you're even now preparing places for us, we who have put our faith in you and trust you for our salvation. We pray that you would be with those left behind who grieve, everyone in our congregation, family of faith, who has had to bid farewell to a loved one. We pray your comforting grace and presence would be with them. We pray that your healing hand would be on those who are struggling with various physical challenges. We are reminded, as always, that these bodies are fragile and that eventually they wear out, they fail us. But our spirits are eternal, and we thank you for that. We pray that we would give thought and attention to that through the course of our lives. We thank you for the privilege of being here in this place to worship you, the songs we sing for Addison's baptism, and for the opportunity to contribute to your cause with our resources. We pray that you would use all of that to accomplish your purpose and your will on this earth. All for your glory, we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. you, choir. It's one of the most meaningful hymns of our faith, and beautifully done by the musically talented people we have here in our congregation at Central Baptist Church. And we should be grateful that God has blessed us as richly as He has in that respect. They minister to us every week, and like you, I am grateful for it. A year behind schedule, fraught with controversy in the host country, the 2020 Olympics have finally gotten underway this week, as you probably know. You may watch some of it. You may be blessed by it. Some of the best athletes in the world are going to be competing against one another, trying to win medals, and preferably gold medals. That's what they seek. And I can only imagine the amount of training that they have endured to get them where they are, but that training has put them in top form and brought them to a place of peak physical conditioning. They are prepared to go for the gold, and I admire them for their discipline, for their physical fitness. The world admires them for that. They put their physical fitness on display during the Olympic Games. People all over the world will watch. But what about spiritual fitness? And how is it put on display? Is it valued? Is it prioritized to the extent that physical fitness is in our world? 15 years ago, a year-end poll of over 7,600 respondents asked a single question: what's your number one goal for the new year? And the top two answers were lose weight and maintain a healthier lifestyle related to physical well-being. Only 5% said that they were going to focus on spirituality. But we are eternal spiritual beings. We know that our bodies are eventually going to die. We see evidence of it every day, incontrovertible evidence. Some of us see the progress of that in the mirror each morning. I know I do. We know that's going to happen, and yet we devote so much energy and attention to our bodies. Shouldn't we devote at least as much energy and effort to spiritual fitness as we do to physical fitness? Interestingly enough, the Apostle Paul makes that very point by contrasting spiritual fitness and discipline to physical fitness and discipline in 1 Corinthians chapter 9. We're going to be looking at the passage of Scripture immediately following the one we looked at last Sunday morning. We'll be reading verses 24 to 27 of 1 Corinthians 9, where Paul says that spiritual fitness, like physical fitness, also requires rigorous training, but that it produces a more enduring reward. If you're able, I invite you to stand with me for the reading of God's Word as I read this passage for us. After Paul says in the preceding verses, to the weak I became weak to win the weak, I become all things to all men, so that by all possible means I might save some. I do all this for the sake of the gospel, that I may share in its blessings. He then asks, do you not know that in a race all the runners run, but only one gets the prize? Run in such a way as to get the prize. Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last. But we do it to get a crown that will last forever. Therefore, I do not run like a man running aimlessly. I do not fight like a man beating the air. No, I beat my body and make it my slave, so that after I have preached to others, I myself will not be disqualified for the prize. Thank you. Please take your seats. this little paragraph that we just read makes obvious use of athletic metaphors like running and boxing. That was something that was really rather common in the Greek philosophic tradition, just as it is common in the modern evangelical preaching tradition. We preachers like to use sports metaphors because people understand those things. They resonate. And Paul was doing the same thing. In fact, it meant even more, perhaps, to the Corinthians because of the nearby Isthmian Games. They took place there near Corinth, within 10 miles, because they were called the Isthmian Games because of the isthmus, that's hard to say, I-S-T-H-M-U-S, isthmus of Corinth, the little land bridge that was situated there between the two larger segments of land that make up Greece. These games, the Isthmian Games, were second only to the Olympics. They were held every 2 years, very near to Corinth. They attracted thousands of competitors and visitors from all over the empire. It makes sense that Paul would connect them to what he's trying to say, that he would use that as an illustration, because he's just doing what he said he does in those previous verses. He's trying to relate to those Corinthians. He's becoming all things to all people so that he might save some. And so he says, it's like in the games. He asked this question in verse 24 that's rhetorical, really. Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last, but we do it to get a crown that will last forever. The question he asked prior to expounding that way was, don't you know that in a race all the runners run, but only one gets the prize? Well, of course they knew. They knew about the games. They didn't have them on television where they could watch them in the comforts of their living rooms. But they attended, they watched, they knew how runners run. And Paul says here that Christians as well need to run to win the prize. We should run our spiritual race the same way these athletes run their physical races. Run in such a way as to win the prize. Now, what does he mean? Well, he's not suggesting that there's only one prize and only one of us can win it, the one who outruns all the rest of us. No, not at all. That may work that way in athletic competition, but the Christian life and its accompanying spiritual discipline is not a contest in the sense of being a competition. Now, we are inclined, unfortunately, to compare ourselves with others in our Christian lives instead of, as we should, comparing ourselves with the only one who is perfect. But it's not a competition to see who can be first. What Paul is saying is that athletes give it their all. They don't hold anything back. They make a complete effort to win the prize. These days, athletes say that they give 110%. Athletes aren't usually math majors. But we know what they mean when they say that, don't we? They give it everything they've got. They try to win the prize. And verse 25 says, they go into strict training. Literally, they exercise self-control, self-discipline in all things, just in order to compete. They have to do that just to get into the competition. According to Plato, any athlete entered in the Olympics, and presumably also in the Isthmian Games, was required to go into 10 months of strict training and was subject to disqualification if he didn't do it. They had to train just to run the race. So Paul says we should run our race with the same kind of effort, the same kind of discipline, if we want to avoid what he calls disqualification in verse 27. If physical fitness requires strict training, as Paul says it does, then it shouldn't be any surprise that spiritual fitness requires strict training as well. But a lot of folks these days want the prize without the pain. They want the destiny without the discipline, don't they? And they wind up in all sorts of trouble. Dallas Willard said, "Spirituality, wrongly understood or pursued, is a major source of human misery and rebellion against God." And we see a good bit of that in our day and time as people in their confusion try to fill that spiritual void in their lives with all kinds of different things. But they resist any sort of guidance or authority. You know, you hear people say, "I'm spiritual, but I'm not religious." And neither are we, if you think about it. Religion has a negative connotation. It's ritual. It's empty. It's in many ways meaningless. But what they're saying is they don't want the guidance of a historical, traditional faith that has been passed down from generation to generation from ancient days. And as a result, they run off course in all sorts of different kinds of ways, trying to fill that spiritual void. And so they find themselves in human misery, even rebellion against God. Tony Campolo said something similar. He suggests that our culture is seeking spiritual rewards through material means, through materialism and consumerism. Let me read part of what he says. It's a little extended quote here. He says, "In our advertising, it's as though the ecstasy of the spirit experienced by a Saint Teresa or a Saint Francis can be reduced to gratification coming from a particular car. And the kind of love that Christ compared to his love for the church can be expressed by buying the right kind of gift for that special person in your life." He said, "Before, spiritual gratification could come only via spiritual means. And thus people were urged to choose between the things of this world and the blessings of God. Now, that duality has been overcome." He says, "Ours is an age in which spiritual blessings are being promised to those who buy material things. The spiritual is being absorbed by the physical. And the fruit of the Spirit, the media suggests, can be had without God and without spiritual disciplines." The media may be trying to sell that, but don't you buy it. The Bible says spiritual rewards derive from a spiritual fitness that only comes through strict training, through self-discipline. There are no shortcuts to physical fitness. There are no shortcuts to spiritual fitness either. Now, let me say a word about that. And I've shared this with you before. There is an immense difference between trying to do something and training to do something. And not understanding that difference is what frustrates so many well-meaning Christians. I've given you illustrations of that before. Say, you want to learn a language. You can try as hard as you want to speak Russian, but if you haven't studied it, nothing but noise is going to come out of your mouth. You can try very hard to play a musical instrument, but if you haven't tried to take a lesson or two, trained a little bit, then it's going to be very dissonant in its sound. You know, I have a lot of instruments at home, mostly guitars, but in my closet I have a saxophone because I like how the saxophone sounds. I would like to be able to play it. All I've been able to do so far is scare the cat. They don't like the sound of bad noises coming out of saxophones, I can tell you. But I hope that maybe one day, if I ever retire or have more time, that I can train a little bit, I can learn a little bit, take a lesson or two, be able to make something that sounds good come out of that. Well, the Christian life is very much the same. A lot of Christians try very hard to be like Jesus, and then they fail, and they get frustrated, and they don't understand why, they get discouraged. They've tried and they've tried, but they haven't trained. Don't just try to be like Jesus, train to be like Jesus, incrementally. a step at a time, a little bit at a time. That's how we train and how we grow to be like Christ. I've been doing this over half a century now. What Addison did before, I did 50 years and 3 weeks ago. I still see how far I have to go in my training, in my preparation. But when I look back, I see how far I've come. Sometimes the growth is so gradual that we may not even notice. But if we're not training, we're not growing at all. Spiritual fitness requires spiritual discipline. And spiritual discipline has been defined this way: any activity that can help me gain power to live life as Jesus taught it and as Jesus modeled it. Any activity that will help me gain power to live life as Jesus taught and as Jesus modeled it. That's what spiritual discipline is. And there are various spiritual disciplines we've talked about before: prayer, worship, study, giving, solitude, silence. There are many things that we can employ to train to be like Jesus. And the relationship between disciple and discipline is obvious, isn't it? If you want to be a disciple, you must discipline yourself to follow your leader. To discipline yourself to learn from him, to be like him. So many just want what he has to offer, want his grace, want to go to heaven when their bodies do finally give out on them, but they aren't interested in learning to live as he taught us to live. John Ortberg defines a disciplined person this way. He says it's someone who can do the right thing at the right time, in the right way, with the right spirit, for the right reason. That's a disciplined person. We have to train ourselves to be able to do that. Christians who reach that level of spiritual fitness don't get there by running aimlessly, as Paul says in verse 26, like a man beating the air, like a shadow boxer, if you will, but instead by self-discipline over our flesh, our bodies, as he says in verse 27. Because it's there where many of our sinful inclinations originate. We must discipline ourselves in body and run in such a way as to get the prize, to win the medal. What does Paul say about the prize for which we run? Is it a gold medal? No. No, it's much better than that. In verse 25, Paul says, everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last. But we do it to get a crown that will last forever. He's hoping those Corinthians are smart enough to see the difference. They do it for a crown that will not last. You see, athletes don't train for nothing. They do compete for a prize. Now, you could argue that physical fitness itself is a worthy goal, is a prize in and of itself. And the Apostle Paul acknowledges that in another passage of Scripture. In 1 Timothy 4, he says something similar to what he says here in 1 Corinthians. He says, train yourself to be godly, for physical training is of some value, but godliness has value for all things, holding promise for both the present life and the life to come. So physical fitness is a worthy goal in itself, but spiritual fitness is even more so. It prepares us for eternity. But not only that, it enables us to be victorious in the everyday spiritual battles of the Christian life. There is tremendous reward in spiritual fitness in and of itself. I could say a lot more about that. I have said a lot more about that. But it isn't what Paul has in mind in verse 25. He's thinking here more long term. He's seeing eternity, and which is more valuable for that. In the Isthmian Games, the victors, that is, were rewarded a laurel or pine wreath, a crown that was put on their heads. But it was already deteriorating before they even received it. It was already suffering decay. It was already withering. But even the glory and the renown and the opportunities and the wealth that still come to victorious competitors in the games today, they are temporal things. They are perishable things. They don't last. They're yesterday's news before you know it. But the prize we pursue, the crown we crave, is one that never tarnishes, never withers, never perishes, never fades. The Bible says it lasts forever. Because it isn't a material crown, it's a spiritual crown. And that crown is described in various ways in the Scripture. In 2 Timothy, Paul calls it a crown of righteousness. Peter, in 1 Peter 5, calls it a crown of glory. James and the risen Lord himself call it the crown of life. But listen to what Isaiah says. Isaiah says, in that day, the Lord Almighty will be a glorious crown, a beautiful wreath for the remnant of his people. That's poetic language, but it communicates truth. In some mysterious way that we can't yet comprehend or understand, the Lord himself will be our crown, along with his righteousness and his glory and his life, eternal and forever. It's the crown we pursue. Far better than any earthly crown or Olympic gold medal for that matter. The crown we crave is worth the effort. It is worth the discipline. It is worth the training. It is worth everything. So are you pursuing it? That's a simple question, isn't it? But it's a penetrating question. Are you pursuing the only crown that counts? Or are you wasting time and energy pursuing things that don't last, that are ultimately meaningless? Are you running aimlessly, trying to fill that spiritual void within you that longs for God? Jesus Christ wore a crown of thorns to give us the opportunity to wear the crown of life. Jesus paid it all on our behalf to extend his forgiveness to us. He suffered for us. He satisfied the just penalty for our sins so we could be forgiven and restored to a right relationship with a holy God. And to continue Paul's metaphor here, you enter the race by putting your faith and trust in Jesus Christ and availing yourself of the free grace of God to have forgiveness and restoration. But don't settle for just being in the race. Go for the gold. That's the real prize. You can be spared an eternal misery by putting your faith in Christ, your trust in Christ. But if you want to experience the abundant life that Christ came to give us, then run in such a way as to win the prize. The measure of your commitment and your investment determines the measure of your reward. You don't hear that an awful lot in evangelical circles. But it's true. The measure of your commitment and your investment determines the measure of your reward. It says so in the Scripture. Salvation is free, but there is a discipline involved in winning the prize. You know, it's been said the gospel is opposed to earning. It is not opposed to effort. God expects us to invest ourselves in apprenticeship to Jesus Christ, to work alongside Him. We don't do it alone. We have the Holy Spirit within us to help us. God desires for us to grow in Christ's likeness. It's what we were created for. God will help us do it. But if you're running aimlessly, not sure where you're going, what you're doing, looking for something you don't even know, when you find it, then this might be the time to reassess, to take to heart these words of the Apostle Paul, to go for the gold that God wants for us. That's how you experience the richness and the fullness of the abundant life that Christ came to give us. So how are you running the race? Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we are grateful that in our distress, you came to us in the person of your Son, Jesus Christ, to pay the just and righteous penalty for our sins so that we might be forgiven, that we might have relationship with you, that we might enter the race. But you've called us to do more than that, Lord. You have so much more in store for us. I pray that we might commit ourselves today to run in such a way as to win the prize. God, some of us are at the starting line. Others of us are nearing the finish in the span of our lives. May we this day recognize that our spiritual fitness is truly what counts. Make it so, God, for your glory and your sake. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing a song of response, give you opportunity to do your business with the Lord, whatever that may be. If you have a decision for Christ, for His church, if you need to get in the race, we can help you do that. If you need to be baptized, we have water to do that. If you need counsel, if you need direction, if you need help, we can do all of those things. But the one thing I hope you will not leave here without doing is renewing and refreshing your commitment to run the race set before you in such a way as to win the prize. Go for the gold, friends. You will not be disappointed. Let's stand together, and as we're led, if you need to come, you come.
Oh,
Thank you for your attention this morning, friends. I want you to grab your worship folder. After I say a brief prayer, we're going to have a responsive spoken benediction and then a sung benediction. And the words for all of that are found in your worship folder. But first, let's pray together. God, we thank you for this opportunity we've had today to worship you. We thank you for the challenges that you've set before us to live higher and better than we naturally would, that you've called us to something better, something more noble, something more glorious. And I pray that we would pursue it with everything within us. God, we thank you for inspiring us today through baptism, through singing, through the word. And I pray that you'd guide our steps as we prepare to go. And I ask it all in Christ's name. Amen. Now, to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.